Good evening, everyone. I'm Jamila Mizek. It's wonderful having you with us. Morton Salt employees staging a sick-out down at the Inagua plant after three members of the Bahamas Industrial Manufacturers and Allied Workers Union were suspended with pay and another slapped with a written warning. Here's what Union President Jennifer Brown had to say during an interview with our news team.
How many employees will be involved?
How many? About 40.
40 out of how many working on the plant?
I can't say how many are out there now because I didn't go to work this morning. But it sounds as if the supervisors are trying to operate the machines and everything now.
According to the letter dated February 6th, the suspension is for 7 days pending an investigation. The reason cited that the employees knowingly and willfully violated Article 2.1 of their industrial agreement, which notes that the employee must actively implement any action necessary to assure the efficient and economic operation of the company through an orderly and constructive relationship between the management of Morton Salt Bahamas Limited and the union. The letter goes on to point out that the investigation will also explore the potential that the reprimanded employee may have violated the last chance agreement dated April 23, 2018. The company is expected to make a determination on the matter before February 14th. The letters are signed by Morton's general manager, Michael Nixon. The union plans to meet on Saturday to discuss their next move. Meantime, a free day for students of C.W. Sawyer Primary. The Ministry of Education canceled classes for students for the remainder of the week. The school's closure comes a day after parents protested against ongoing concerns about mold, rat infestation, and structural problems at the Tonic William Starling Highway campus.
We have been working assiduously to address that. Mr. Donovan Turnquest, the Deputy Permanent Secretary, who is responsible for the physical plant, I mean the entire physical system of the ministry, met yesterday with the teachers, sought their concerns, addressed those concerns. We have been working on the campus, addressing whatever the issues are, have been for the last couple of weeks, okay? And that is an ongoing process at the moment.
Education Minister Jeffrey Lloyd also noted similar concerns coming out of Black Point Exuma.
The Black Point School also is being addressed and has been addressed. The facilities manager went there and did a scope of works along with the Ministry of Works, and we have already contracted somebody to take care of those issues, definitely.
The minister also commented on the altercation between a teacher and students of C.H. Reeves Jr., noting that he's still awaiting reports from the police, as well as those involved in the altercation. In the meantime, the ministry, he said, is implementing the teacher's suggestions on how best to ensure safety.
Those are being aggressively implemented as we speak right now. A lot of it has to do with sensitization, as well as, of course, training and, a reminder about why we are on our school campuses, both for the learning and teaching process. But we are here to make sure that our teachers and our students and everybody else are safe and protected.
A similar altercation occurred at the C.V. Bethel High School last month. Meantime, the opposition's point man on finance, its deputy leader Chester Cooper, has a pretty dismal prediction for what the midterm budget will offer Bahamians, and that's an increase in the rate of value-added tax, other taxes, or the need to borrow more money. Now this, granted, he expressed hope that he is wrong.
I predicted this, not just by examining the revenue shortfalls, inclusive of December's collections.
You're doing well.
But also the expenditure patterns. And the borrowing report and an assessment on customs as a barometer of consumption is down in all major categories, most major categories.
Well, that feeds pretty well.
The lower than expected spending in discretionary categories like capital expenditure, 29%, yeah. Utilities, 30.2%, tourism-related expenditure, 23%, are all significantly below the overall expenditure trend of 42 to 45%.
This said, Mr. Cooper, in addition to the need to examine vendor and VAT refund payables, but in a cautionary note, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance Peter Turnquest warned the PLP MP of what he called his recurrent mischief.
It has the ability to cause panic in the economy. And that's and exactly, not just locally, but internationally. And so I just want to caution the member to be circumspect. Because the fact of the matter is this government has not had any discussions about raising any VAT. We've talked about this if you go to our fiscal strategy report, there's nothing in there that talks about an increase in VAT. So I want to just say to the Bahamian people that there is no intention on the part of this government to increase the value-added tax. There's no such discussion, preliminary or otherwise.
Still, Mr. Cooper insisted that once the government brings the mid-year budget, it will be clearer that balancing the budget in 3 years is off the table. That is, without some fundamental restructuring of priorities on both revenue and expenditure side. The PLP MP was at the time debating a resolution to accept the government's fiscal strategy report that saw the Progressive Liberal Party walk out the lower chamber, decrying what its leader Philip Davis called the bullying, boorish, and unparliamentary behavior of St. Anne's MP Brent Simonet. Mr. Simonet is accused of disrupting the order of speakers. Mr. Davis, in a statement, said he will neither be disrespected nor dictated to by the likes of Mr. Simonet. Well, the Deputy Prime Minister is pretty confident the government will meet all the European Union's requirements and avoid being blacklisted. Speaking with reporters on the issue, Minister Turnquest reiterated that it's an evolving process.
There are a few amendments that we can foreshadow to the legislation that we put forward to address some questions that have come up. But we still believe that we're on track and we're looking forward to a favorable review very shortly. I think the Code of Conduct Group will make a decision on the 27th, I believe it is. Don't hold me to it, but either 23rd or 27th. And then we'll know where we are and whether there is any requirement for any additional amendments or initiatives from us. But at this point, we feel very confident. We are continuing the dialogue with the EU and their personnel and demonstrating our commitment to ensuring that we get this right.
Now, coming out of his meeting in Brussels last month, Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis said only that talks with EU officials were successful, stressing that the Bahamas is committed to transparency and good governance.
The industry has certainly been briefed along the way. We should have another briefing very shortly. We keep them informed as to what is going to be the requirements and how we see the practical application of the legislation and the guidance being implemented. So this is, again, a very fluid situation. We are in the process of finalizing our guidance notes, which will give the industry practical guidance as to how they ought to implement the law and the requirements. And the first phase of the monitoring of all of this will be after June, July of this year. So we fully expect to be prepared for the implementation.
Legislators recently passed a compendium of bills essentially aimed at avoiding the dreaded blacklist. Those bills included the Removal of Preferential Exemptions Bill, the Register of Beneficial Ownership Bill, the Nonprofit Organizations Bill, and the Penal Code Amendment Bill. Again, the EU Code of Conduct Group will reveal its conclusion later this month. You're watching JCN News. Stay with us.
This segment of the news was brought to you by Alive.